Europe's Vega is about to launch an important satellite to space that will track the global air movement, aka wind. Why is it important? How does it work? Well, let's find out now on KNews. Hey guys, Lucas here. Welcome to KNews for week 34, 2018. And there's always a big shout out to you, my KNews boosters on Patreon. These people keep me going, and if you want to contribute as well, head over to funding.knews.space. Thanks for your trust. Besides Vega, there are two other rockets about to launch this week, which I want to mention as well so you don't miss what's going up to space. There is a Falcon 9 that will launch from Cape Canaveral on August... Nope, it got delayed to September as I was almost finished with the video. It will head to a geosynchronous transfer orbit, where the upper stage will release its communication satellite. Speaking of it, up top the two-stage rocket is Telstar 18V, as mentioned, a communication satellite for the Canadian company Telesat. I think it's pronounced French, but I'm not sure. A little fun fact, Telstar 1 was the first civilian communications satellite launched to space, which broadcasted some radio and television across the Atlantic Ocean in 1962. If you look carefully, the satellite might remind you of something. Yes, the German company Adidas came up with a new football or foosball design to honor the satellite, and it was named the Adidas Telstar. The shape and color scheme are all inspired by the little satellite. But back to Falcon 9, it will feature a brand new Block 5 booster, which will attempt to land on the drone ship in the ocean again. According to the SpaceX subreddit, there will be no fairing recovery attempted this time. I'm not entirely sure why that is, but it could be simply related to the payload's mass and overall energy needed to get it to the right track. The final slot Telstar will place itself into is at 138 degrees east over East Asia, Australia and Hawaii, all the way to the right. I actually confused the launch in my last video, so if this sounds familiar, it's not a glitch in the Matrix, I just covered it in my last video already. Next up to launch is a Chinese Long March 3B, and it also got delayed to September, guys. Its destination is a medium Earth orbit where the Chinese Baidu navigation constellation is placed. And this means up top are of course two more of these Baidu satellites, which launch quite regularly, almost once a month. Their purpose is to make China independent from the US GPS or global positioning system. But as far as I know, everyone will be able to use it, like Europe's Galileo and Russia's GLONASS. India has a navigation system as well, but it is as far as I know only meant to boost the GPS accuracy over India's highly populated peninsula. And finally, La Fusée d'Europe, the European Vega rocket. It launched yesterday evening, August 22nd at 2120 UTC from Kourou in French Guiana, which is in the north of South America, close to the equator. It will head north following a sun-synchronous polar orbit with an inclination of 97 degrees. The four-staged rocket will carry the IOLOS weather satellite, which will test a new system that will be used on more future satellites. IOLOS is the first to map three-dimensional air movements, aka wind, in the upper regions of our atmosphere from space. While previous methods using satellites and planes just observed clouds and waves to measure the wind above oceans indirectly, IOLOS will shoot the air with a strong ultraviolet laser to get the information it needs. Winds above oceans are important since this is mostly where big weather events are born. I think everyone knows giant hurricanes, but there are also heat waves as witnessed recently in Europe. These are caused by unusual and static streams of air blocking each other off, trapping the heat above a certain area without clouds having a chance to reach them. It didn't rain in June and July over here. Knowing how exactly the air is moving allows us to make better and most importantly earlier predictions so people on Earth can react in time and are not caught by surprise. How all of this works is actually not that complicated and, as I think, also interesting. In order to understand it, you have to know the Doppler effect or Doppler shift, named after, who had guessed it, an Austrian physicist, Christian Doppler. You probably know this from school or hundreds of videos already, so I'll make it real quick. Like sound, light waves can be squeezed when they emit from a moving object. The faster the object, the more densely they spread, since there is a speed limit at which they can travel, the speed of light. This means the color shifts as the light color depends on the so-called wavelength. So light emitting from a moving object gets squeezed and therefore color shifted. If you now take a mirror where the light bounces back to the source, you can actually figure out how quickly the mirror is moving relative to you just by comparing both waves with each other. This is done with a complex machinery, but you don't need to understand that in order to understand the overall principle. This is almost exactly how ILO's instrument works, only that they don't compare the wavelength. The wavelength of ultraviolet light is way too small and would not really measure the movement of the air as a whole, but individual molecules. There would be way too much noise, since molecules fly in many directions randomly. So what these clever people do instead is to shoot 100 short bursts or pulses at the atmosphere for 7 seconds, pause a couple seconds and repeat. So instead of using and being limited to a small wavelength, they can do the same comparing the pulse distances of the outgoing and reflected signals. I find this amazing, but maybe it's just me. A question that may come up is, hey, why don't they simply use a much bigger wavelength? Well, the answer is because air does only reflect very specific spectra, meaning a much longer micro or radio wave would simply move through it, otherwise we could not communicate wirelessly. So they need a very specific wavelength, which is in this case 355 nanometers. A so-called single mode laser can produce exactly that one frequency of light. This is essential as the speed of light through air varies based on the frequency. Having a multitude of frequencies, the overall signal would spread out and cause a giant, hardly usable mishmash. As you may have noticed, the satellite will orbit Earth at an angle of 35 degrees, which is needed in order to track vertical and horizontal movements. Just pointing the telescope part down would mean it could only track vertical up and down winds, but not the important horizontal parts. The final data will look a little like this. The resolution is with a couple square kilometers very low, but it is only the first of many future satellites, as mentioned. And the final topic I want to talk about is, of course, the launch itself. Vega is basically a giant firework burning a solid fuel and oxidizer mix. It's a little dirty, but relatively cheap and fail-safe. Once Vega is going, nothing can stop it, except maybe its termination sequence. It will go through its staging, with the last one being a liquid-fueled upper stage that burns hypergolics. The satellite will be inserted into a 320 km high circular orbit and will afterwards push itself 80 km higher, where it will operate for around about 4 years. The rather low altitude means it needs a lot of fuel to correct its course and stay up in space, so it will simply run out of it at some point. What I find a little uncomforting is that the satellite will orbit pretty much in ISS space, so I'm sure we will hear about some rather close encounters in the future. The satellite could in theory shoot the ISS with its laser, so I hope no one will be able to hack it. Are you maybe able to hack satellites? Please let me and the NSA know in the comments. Okay, that shall conclude this week's episode, and I hope to see you in the next one if you like, and don't forget to subscribe. You can also help KNews to become a self-sustaining YouTube colony by supporting me on Patreon or buying the new official KNews Space merch. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.